Welcome on the. We have Dr. Jha, who is going to give us a guest lecture on how to take care of yourself and not give in the temptation of doing those rock hard cataracts and doing it the fake-o chop way. That way, you don't want to get your heart opened up by some cardiac surgeon. Welcome, Dr. Jha. We'll start with him. I will request everybody to stick to your time because we have a GBM at 4 and we would like to reach there at 4. Thank you so much. Dr. Kuresh Maskati, Dr. Sameer, would you be happy to join me over here? Till Dr. Jha is getting his talk ready, I would like to open a question to the audience. How many of you have a code blue form available in your hospital? A code blue form format expected from you, madam? Anybody else? Yes. Excellent. So we need to understand that whether or not we're talking about NABH or any other accreditation systems, there are basic form formats and basic necessities of documentation which are required in your hospital. That's what we're going to talk about, besides many other things. Dr. Jha, over to you. I think you're ready now.
Good afternoon, everybody. I am thankful to Dr. Lalit Verma to give me the opportunity to interact with you. We are all here in this session, which is a very right way to address our situation and problems and how to look after our patients. That is our primary job, to look after patients. And we'll be talking again. There are very good speakers here. We'll talk, give you tips and clues on how to handle your patients well, how to make them happy, how to make them aware of their rights. Everything is there. I am going from the other side. In fact, I am going to spoil the party. So we have a Hippocratic Oath. We are bound by certain our duties, our commitments, everything that doctors have been told from day one. Doctors are known as God, supposed to be known as God. I don't know where we stand now. It's again supposed to be a noble profession. We are the noble gentlemen. We should always behave well. We should not lose our temper. We should not misbehave. That is our primary job. You can get a request, doctor, please do your best, even in spite of telling that it's beyond your means, your capabilities, or the situation doesn't warrant that you can handle this case, but still you'll be asked, and many times you get tempted and carried away by the request and do land up in a situation when everything reverses after the something goes wrong in that case. It's a changing time, and we have to change with time. Definitely you change your attitude. You have to be absolutely professional when you are dealing with a situation, any situation, even routine cases or a difficult case, doesn't matter. And you are no longer a holy cow. Your patient don't take you at your word, that you can be very sure. If they're always in doubt, whenever you advise surgery, they always go for a second opinion to confirm whether the advice is correct or not. In fact, we have become a whipping boy in the society. A complication from medical perspective is always negligence from the patient's point of view. That we have to accept it now. That is how the patient looks at it. And the ultimate evaluation is not done by a medical board, but the court of law. And court, besides evaluating legally, also starts taking a very sympathetic attitude towards the aggrieved party, which always happens to the patient. Coming to the difference between the medical and legal profession that we have to understand, we work on trust. What we talk, what the patient tells us, we believe them. When we talk to them, they are supposed to believe us. The law works on a very different ground, with different perspective altogether. They totally work on distrust. So I will just give you an example. Suppose in the record kicking, if there's any override, unintentional I'm talking, any deviation, different dates on the same page, lack of entry time, they are all taken as tampering of records by the court of law. That you must understand and be very careful while you're documenting your records, even in routine cases. Judges, we cannot blame the judges because the system is almost fallacious. There is no provision of advisory jury in our Indian legal system. They are not bound or are supposed to seek medical advice. Treatment, we all know, is a journey that we undertake with our patients. We both travel together from the day we examine the patient, we carry out the surgery, post-op follow-up, till the date when we have a final follow-up and tell them, okay, you are fine. And we have to travel together, behave in a way that everybody else expects to be behaved. We are talking about the patient's right. What about your right? We always talk about their right. I think there is a talk by none other than Samir Sood, you are talking to the patient. You are talking to
change the topic.
Okay, you change the topic. Good. Surgical procedure. We all know that Sita had only one Agni Parikshak. A surgeon crosses fire every time. We all know when we perform a surgery, what things we go in our heart, when the things go wrong, how the heart beats misses, how the blood pressure goes up, everything. We have to go through this trauma of pressure every surgical procedure that we take. And when complication occur, you lose your sleep, you lose your appetite, you lose your peace of mind. So what should be the patient attitude when you land up in a complication, which you have not done intentionally, it happens. There will be no complication-free medical services, at least for next 50 to 100 years. I can see that. Maybe when the robotics come 100%, maybe, but it's still not possible. Should he shout at us? Should he threaten you to take you to court or retort to physical violence, which of course the news are very prevalent these days, you can see in the newspapers. And court of law, I can tell you, only understands documentation. There is no place for emotion or compassion. Many times patients tell you, cut down the cost, you cut on consumables, you cut on investigations. But if the case goes to the court of law, the court is not going to accept any of these excuses. Why did you not carry out? Because you wanted to cut the cost. And I can tell you 100% the patient will be totally giving absolutely other version there in the court of law. And so there's nothing like helping attitude. You should be totally professional, put the things across as it is. Patient goes away, doesn't matter. I can tell you can survive bad surgeries, but you can't survive a bad documentation. So protect yourself by good, methodical, continuous documentation. Coming to legal help, you must have a lawyer in your good book. You must have a relationship with a lawyer, professional. I'm not talking about friendship with your lawyer. It's something like a family physician. These days, you must have a family sort of lawyer. Because a honest lawyer is very important. There is a difference when we take up the case and we land up in a complication, we are liable. A lawyer even loses the case, he has no liability. So no lawyer will ever normally refuse a case. So you have to be careful that he gives you or she gives you an honest opinion about your case, where you stand in this situation. And try to avoid going to the court. It's a big trauma, I can tell you that. And an honest lawyer is of great help. So we all know this dialogue. We are not here to make friends. We are professionals. We will treat our patients in an absolutely professional manner. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Thank you, Dr. Jha. I think we have now ready to listen to Dr. Samir Sood, who is a co-founder at Sharpsight Eye Hospitals. He's going to talk to us about how to build your team. The most important resource in a hospital is human resources, and quality and safety in a high eye hospital is everybody's responsibility, from the doorman to the chairman, as the saying goes. And it will be interesting to listen to Dr. Samir's view about how you can build a faithful team, somebody who will stand by you, not in the good days, but also in the bad days. Dr. Samir, are we ready with your presentation? Yeah, please go ahead.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Dr. Jha, for a lovely insight. You also happen to be my guru. He's taught me a lot of ophthalmology. So thank you for induction into ophthalmology. Here, as you can see, I haven't given my name, and it's for a reason, because the organization is always bigger than the individual, and that's what I'm trying to show here. So we talk about patient delight, right? That's the end goal, because when the patient is delighted, then everything falls in place. But who are the people who give the delight? We generally tend to forget the most important aspect of this, and they are the human resources who are working with you. I'm not saying for you, but with you. And that's the most important thing. Can you give me the timer so I can get carried away? So I must acknowledge that in my school, I learned the first step of team building, and I was challenged to ring the bell, which denotes a chutti on that day. It was not supposed to be a chutti. I went up, I rang the bell. It was not the time of mobile, so nobody could bring back 600 people back. So it was declared a chutti, and lot of people, at least 100 people knew who had rung the bell, and the principal was after us that who has rung the bell. And can you imagine, the whole school kept quiet. We were given rigorous punishment for 7 days, and not one person gave my name away. And that was my first lesson for team building. Then of course I'm ex-army, and it's really a pinnacle of what team spirit is all about. People in the army give life for each other. I don't think there can be anything bigger. I was in Gangaram, where I learned a lot of team building, how the doctors take the big decisions, is not, how they build a team there. And of course, I have my Lagan team of Shapshed. I'm going to show you some photos in the future slides. So it's only a delightful team which is a key to a patient delight. A good surgery is a very small aspect, very important, I do agree, but it's a very small aspect. You have to actually, like Dr. Zamindar said, you have to thrill the patient from beginning to the end, right from the entry to the exit. It's only then that everything falls in place. So what is a team? So a team is a group of people with different strengths and learnings. This is very important. There's no point having people in the team who have the same strengths and same weaknesses. So have a team, select a team which has different strengths, and you cover the weaknesses and work on the strengths. And they should have a common purpose. You can't have a team with different purposes. You know, like in a cricket team, everyone wants to win. There can be a bowler, there can be a batsman, there can be a wicketkeeper, there can be fielders, etc., etc. But the common purpose is to win. Okay, so you have to do that. And the team can be as small as two or as big as infinite. You know, they've written 1,000, but it's infinite. Now, what is a delightful team? Delightful team is where every member is actually looking forward to come to your place of work. You'll be surprised, in my organization, people are running fever and all sorts of illnesses, but they yet prefer to come to the organization and work rather than sitting at home. And how do you get a delightful team? You have to give joint decisions. You make joint decisions. Just don't take a decision and give it to them. Involve them in decision making is very, very important, because then they start feeling a part of the organization. They start feeling as if they own the organization. You should have absolute clarity of roles. You know, lot of organizations I've seen where there's a lot of ad hocism. Everyone thinks unka kaam sab kuch hai, but actually
I left find England the roles, 89.
Review them on those roles, and you know, you should be like a orchestra master. Only then good music comes out, because that's how you are doing it. You know, if you are
I left England 89 not and doing, I started
giving the roles properly, then it's just noise that's coming out.
And those days there are no mobile phones.
Yeah. And okay, then there should be a good feel factor. There should be no infighting. It's very, very common.
I left England in 89 and I started working in a hospital in Calcutta.
The management should ensure,
and those days there are no mobile phones.
Okay. So and this, as you can see from the arrows, it's a two-way street. So your team should look up at the management, and the management should also look up at the team. And how do you do that? So first you have to trust your team. There are lots of us who will not trust anybody. You cannot build a team if you don't have, if you can't. How do you gain trust? The only way you can gain a trust is to first give the trust. Only then you can start gaining the trust. Then empower them. In our organization, if we, it's a very flattish organization, but if we empower people, we actually lose that power ourselves. It's like, for example, if I tell my counselor that you can give a discount up to 50% or 40% or whatever, that's the power I've given. Even if I want to give the discount, I need to ask that person. I can't overrule. You know, they don't feel fulfilled. Respect them. Every person in the organization, even from your safai wala to your lift operator to everyone, needs the respect. And this I've learned from my golf, because if you respect your caddy, caddy is the guy who lifts your golf clubs, he will give you such great inputs. But if you shout at them, he'll make sure he gives you wrong clubs, wrong line, and you just spoil your game. You must always keep listening to everyone. I take inputs even from a lift operator, and be very transparent. In our organization, all the doors are even of glass, so that everybody knows that there's transparency and what's going on behind the door. So who's a delighted patient? So a delighted team will have a delightful patient. And who's a delightful patient in short term? It's a person who'll always come back to you, regardless of the cost you do or whatever happens. He's one captivated person who's absolutely, under your care and command, like they say. And he'll always refer a patient. Like we would tell our friends about a blockbuster movie. We don't ask for a person to get a review, ki ye movie kaisi thi. If the movie is good, we'll tell 10 people about it. I'll go a little fast. So what happens when you have a delighted patient, then what happens is they translate their happiness to other patients. So that was the most important slide. What a delightful team will create a delightful patient. These are some of the points which tell us about who a delightful patient is. So I don't think I have time for all that. I need to speak something more. So how do you motivate a team? So in our organization, there's a huge aspect of reward and recognition. You need to tell everyone, even for the smallest of, let's say, anything good that happens in the organization, you need to tell people, you need to recognize, you need to say, well done. Most of us will forget to do all this. Only when a bad thing happens, we'll shout at them. Then there should be a lot of fun times together. And there are some photographs which show, here I took my marketing team all the way to Zojela Pass at 14,000 feet. I flew them down. I give them reward and recognition there. Most of them had gone for a flight for the first time. I'm telling you, it's this reason that my attrition rate is close to less than 2%. I think it's unhealthy, but that's how we do it. And here, that's me giving reward and recognition. We also celebrate together. So here we have gone to Rishikesh for a rafting trip. And we go for marriages together. In our organization, it's very expensive to get married, because you have 300 people coming for that marriage. So when my daughter got married, I was really wondering, kisko bulaun, kisko na bulaun. So I said, chalo, sabon ko hi bula leta hun. And 300 of them came for my daughter's wedding. We do a lot of activities together. So people who do activities together, who eat together, who celebrate together, then they generally tend to stay together. And they produce their best, and they provide absolute delight to the patients, which is the need of the hour. Thank you.
Dr. Sameer, thank you so much. One question for you. How do individual practitioners extrapolate the information what you have for 300 staff? Is it possible, and how do they start?
Yeah.
Because you said trust the team, respect them. How do you start this chain? Do you have any ideas about how an individual practitioner who has a team of, say, 5 people, how does he ensure that there is no attrition?
Right. So the concept remains the same. Okay, whether you have 2 people or 2 lakh people, the concept remains the same. Even if you have 1 person, then you start trusting that one person, who could be your multi-purpose worker. Like when I started my practice, he used to be driving me, he used to be sitting at my reception, he used to be assisting me in my OT, etc., etc.
Right.
But then you have to trust them. Okay, this is what you need to do. And whatever they say, just trust it, unless they really, really falter. The other thing is that you need to clearly define their roles. You need to say, okay, you need to do these 5 things. Otherwise, if you don't tell them, a lot of times they will miss a lot of important things, and they do something which is unnecessarily. So the concepts of all these, team building, like, I say, you have to celebrate together. If he does something nice, just give him a small gift. Something like that.
Thank you, Dr. Yeah. Sameer. Yeah. One thing from my own personal experience is that however big or small a team you have, don't have favorites, that this is my favorite staff. That causes a lot of problems. So just keep that in mind. I now welcome Dr. Kuresh Maskati to tell us about how do you value your patient's time? Because Time is something which is a limited resource for all of us. And if a patient has to sit for and wait for your services for 2 hours, however good you may be, the chances that he's going to come back to you are less. So those 2 hours, how do you creatively engage? How do you empower the patient? Yes.
Thanks, Amina. So first you have to value your own time and then value everyone else's time. But everyone is important. Everyone's time is equally important. So just to give you an example, when I go to give lectures sometimes at various places, small towns or whatever, and they usually call the meeting at say 7:30 in the evening, but at 7:30 nobody's there. There are 3 people in the audience, and then they said, "Sir, we'll wait for half an hour. Everyone will be coming. They're practicing. They're working." So I always say, "You're not valuing my time, because I have come on time, bang on time to give my talk." So what I do is I carry a few surgical videos with me, because the 3 or 4 people who have come on time don't have to be penalized by having to wait doing nothing for 30 minutes. So I show surgical videos and I will discuss surgical with just something so that their time is well spent till the organizers decide that there's enough audience for me to speak on whatever subject they've invited me to speak. So it's your time and everyone's time which should be equally valued. Today we're going to be talking about patients' time. So why is time management important? Because it allows you to accomplish more in a shorter period of time, which leads actually to more free time, which lets you take advantage of learning opportunities, lowers your stress, and helps to get success in the long run. And when you show your patient that his time is important to you, you build a lasting relationship. So there are very many ways in which to build a lasting relationship. One is to value your patients and value your patient's time. So how do we do this? We reduce non-quality time spent in the clinic. So it's been, patients come to you because they want Dr. Maskati to talk to them. That face-to-face interaction should be the major amount of time that they're spending, not 2 minutes with me and 1.5 hours in my waiting room. So that patients do value their personal time. Everyone's time is important. You're not the only busy person. That person has taken half-day leave to come for his consulting or whatever. So very often we overlook that because we think only we are busy people. So ideally, you need to give them a maximum of face-to-face time that you can give depending on your patient load. By staying on time, he should know that the amount of time you're going to spend and optimizing his time. So let's go, as Samina said, 10 tips to maximize your time. First is while making an appointment. So if a tech-savvy patient makes an appointment, you can register them online with their personal data like contact details, etc., already entered. So when the patient enters the clinic, the chart is already there. It's like when you go to a 5-star hotel and they ask you for your photo ID card. Some of the hotels ask you for this at the time of booking. So everything is there. A Xerox copy of your photo or a photocopy has already been sent to them, especially when we are a group of 30, 40 people checking in at the same time. So it moves much faster if it's been done prior. Second tip. How do I show my patients I care for the time? I need to teach my office staff. If the patient is coming for the first time, you should inform them while making the appointment on the phone itself about approximate time they will need to spend at your clinic, which could vary from clinic to clinic based on your standard operating procedure, whether they're going to go through 5 different people before they see you, 2 different people, whether everyone's going to get dilated, not dilated. They need to know this. In case they're coming by car and they're coming by self-driving, inform them about driving issues with dilated pupils. So these are small things which you need to do. Otherwise, they come by car and then they can't drive back and they're miserable. The other third tip, while the patient is waiting, make sure you provide something at least, either tea, coffee, or at least clean, hygienic water. It doesn't have to be bottled water. I'm against bottled water. But it could be clean, hygienic water. Clear signage showing toilets, and spotlessly clean toilets are a must. Patients come sometimes from long distances, and the first thing they want to do is relieve themselves even before they see you. So your toilets must not be a dissuading factor for them. And if you are keeping reading material, it should be current reading material or some public educational videos over there. Whatever it is, so the time when they're waiting is not lost. And don't leave the patient alone for 1 hour. Though the secretary has said you'll have to wait for 1 hour, let somebody go every 5-10 minutes and tell them what's happening, the things are moving,
and apologizing to them if you're running late. So now the patient has come to your room. When the patient enters your room, listen carefully to the content and emotion of what the patient is saying. This is time well spent. This is what the patient is paying you for. He is paying you to have you listen to him more than your expertise. Many of my patients, for example, I have a large dry eye patient volume. Many of them have got, they're just lonely people who have no one to talk to. Their dry eye is just something which they've imagined, or it's there's a lot of functional overlay. But they are very happy if you listen to them for 5-7 minutes and then give them just the same teardrop that you would have given at the end of 1 minute. You don't need to listen, but that's what they're paying you for. Apologize if the patient is upset with something like waiting too long. Be very free with your apologies. Ask about personal interest. Don't just say sit down and yes, what's troubling you. So comment, especially if it's a child or something like that, comment on a pretty dress that he or she is wearing. Don't do that with adults your age and the opposite sex. But if it's somebody known to you, it's an old patient of yours who's been coming to you for 20 years, then you know a little bit, ask about their spouse, how is he, how is she, or whatever. So establish some sort of rapport and avoid interrupting the patient while the patient is speaking. That's very terrible. Don't criticize or argue with the patient or threaten the patient at any stage. So tip 5, during patient conversation, find behaviors to compliment, such as a good, or in the glaucoma patient I have, who's notorious for his non-compliance. I tell him to put drops twice a day, he'll put it once a day. If I put him on long acting once a day, he'll put it every 3 days. Sometimes the bottle got over and doctor, I was abroad. So for 3 months, he's not used it and things like that. Once he came to me and for one full month, he had actually put the drops. I complimented him. I said, fantastic. Something new is happening in your life. You're really doing a great job. You know, something like that. Speak in a gentle tone, but remember that many of your patients are senior citizens and can't hear you well. So the gentle tone should not be such that they can't hear and they say, what doctor, what doctor? So it should be loud enough that they can hear you. And sometimes the patients repeat the same question. You've just answered it, he's repeated the question. You've explained everything about prognosis, and this, but doctor, will I be able to see, nah? That sort of thing. So then best is to ask them to repeat the answer that you gave last, so that goes into their mind, because they've said it rather than you saying it. And the moment the patient you feel is little doubtful of what you're saying, suggest a second opinion before the patient can ask for it. And at the end, please ask if you have any, do you have any further questions for me? So your patient is fully assured that you have answered every single question. That's the time that he's paying you for. So don't get up abruptly because you think everything is over. You must ask this first question, that are you sure everything is okay? I've answered all your questions. Anything else you can think of? I tell them, anything else you can think of, do send me an email. You might forget something. Next time you come, bring questions on a paper and pen so that you don't forget. Things like that. So you're showing them that you're valuing whatever you want to answer everything of this. So tip 6, value the time when in your cabin. Give them eye contact. Don't look into your laptop entering data. I don't have an EMR. I don't like EMRs. I'm a small minority, I know. But so therefore there is, sometimes I've seen the doctor entering data into his the system while the patient is talking. I have redness in 3 years. Cut, 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 cut. He's typing redness 3 years or whatever like that. So don't do that. Don't have more time looking down on your laptop than looking and giving eye contact. And never ever chat on the phone during the consult. So you need to train your staff. At my clinic, I've got a jamming machine so that the mobile phones don't work. I divert my call, my mobile phone, to the secretary so that as soon as I enter, all calls get diverted. She takes the calls. All the junk calls are removed. The other calls, I tell her, in between patients, every 2 patients, I have a 2-minute, 5-minute break, and she tells me who called. I call back if it's important. But no conversation while the patient is with you. The patient is supreme. No one else, not your family, nobody else has priority over your time, because no one else outside there has paid. This patient has paid. So you can always return calls later on at the end of the session. Tip 7, give full report if needed. So if you have an EMR, generate a full report, immediately hand it over to the patient. It impresses them quite well. Otherwise, tell them you'll send it by email or you'll send it by courier or whatever it is. Don't call them again to the office just to collect a report. That's really not valuing their time. Tip 8, the insurance issues. In Bombay Ophthalmic Association, we don't have these issues, as we don't do any cashless work. However, if the vast majority, if you are doing cashless work, a dedicated staff should handle these cases who's little experienced in this, because often this consumes time due to not your staff inefficiency, but the inefficiency of TPS. So the staff should be trained to be patient with the patients. And you know, it does take time, so the patients need to be told that these TPA things will take a little time and should solve the issues as far as possible without troubling the patients repeatedly. Tip 9, when the patient is ready to go home, avoid delays in post-op discharge. Often unnecessary delays occur because there is multitasking from your staff. You assign somebody to give post-op instructions. That person is doing something else, firing somebody else. All the bills and receipts are not ready. It should have been ready. It's a routine cataract case. A patient is all dressed up, ready to leave, but the last minute things are delaying. That causes a lot of heartburn in the patients. And then no one told me you don't accept credit card payment. Now I'll have to send my relative to the bank or the ATM to withdraw cash, delaying my departure. This is something, again, which you need to tell them right at the beginning, the mode of payment you're going to accept, credit card, no. So everything is ready for, because we don't do cashless, so most of our thing is cash or credit card or NEFT or whatever. But we tell them before the surgery. And the final tip, apologizing does not lower your status. No matter whose fault it has been, if the patient feels his time has been wasted, apologize. You apologize on behalf of your staff. You can't say that my secretary was had a bad day today. You apologize on behalf of the secretary. You can give the secretary hell later in the privacy of your cabin. So remember to apologize to relatives as well because of the patients, because they have taken time to come. Even their time is valuable. And besides, they are potential patients whom you cannot afford to antagonize. I apologize if I've overloaded your brains. Thank you so much.
Any questions for Dr. Maskati? One thing which I like, Dr. Maskati, last time when he spoke in the IC, he said that, do a vendor selection every year at the beginning of the year. See, we use the same vendors, say, for the last 10 years, and things might have changed. There might be other vendors who are there who are giving better quality stuff at a lower rate or something, you know, and you sort of blindly do this. So now I've taken his tip from last year, and now we have a vendor selection for all our disposables and everything in the beginning of the year. This year I take a tip from him that you ask the patient to repeat the answer, repeat what you have said. That's amazing. Dr. Gagan Dudeja is not able to join us today, but I will be talking about what he has to talk. That is patient safety. We cannot talk about quality without talking about safety. And typically I talk about NABH, and so people do get frightened when they see me because they think that, you know, she's going to talk about NABH. But let me tell you, today we're not going to talk about NABH, but the 10 things is standard operating procedures or uniformity and care of the patient. If you are able to implement these 10 aspects in your practice, with or without NABH. First, you will definitely be able to benchmark with NABH, but otherwise you will have your outcomes in terms of patient satisfaction will drastically improve. So at the beginning of the session, I had asked a question that how many of you have a code blue form in your hospital? And I just saw two people raising their hands. I had a neighboring ophthalmologist who had a code blue situation on table. And of course, they couldn't save the patient's life. But the first call I made to him and say, whatever papers you have done, I'm sure he must have done a basic, he must have given basic life support and CPR must have been done. But unless and until you have a code blue form in your medical records, and that is going to help you, right? Dr. Jha said that documentation, the code does not believe that you would have done. Did you announce a code blue? Did you do everything? What were the minutes of the code blue? Documented or not. It's a simple example of a very, very important form which should be available in your hospital. Today, if you have not noted anything, if you at least go back to your organization, get a code blue form, train your team on code blue, and see that that is documented whenever there is a code blue situation, you will benefit from this course. So yes, why are we talking about quality? And quality is so important now. We all know that patients are demanding. They Google everything and they come to you. Public expectations are high. And there's an increasing participation in decision making. They want to give their opinion about anything and everything. And there is advancement in knowledge, disease management, and instrumentation. So we all agree on one thing, that management of patient has become complex. And how do we make our lives simple in this complex situation? So patient safety guidelines, very important. I will touch this entire talk, which Dr. Gagan was supposed to say after Dr. KP and Dr. Mohita have spoken. But let's talk about this gentleman. Anybody in the audience can recognize him. He is Mr. Vineet Mitra. He was the one who made Indigo a green carrier. He was the one who made the TAT time, the turnaround time for Indigo flights, is 30 minutes. And he brought a revolution. So when we talk about airlines, we talk about Six Sigma. That means the chance of an error in 3 million opportunities is less than 0.3%. Now, in this situation, when we're talking about healthcare scenarios, we are not even getting warmed up to having standard operating procedures. It's about time that I talk about standard operating procedures in at least 10 different scenarios in your hospital. So why SOP? This, if I consider, is the most important slide in my presentation, because the first thing, you need to have proper checklist at important places. Why do you need checklist? And believe you, it's not a tick list. It is a checklist, because you do not want any of your staff to rely on memory. Simplify steps. Everybody might not have IQ as high as you in your team. Make their lives easy. Have process maps for everything. There is a sterilization process map. There is a sterilization breakdown process map. How important is a sterilization process for you? How easy it is for your staff, your OT staff, to look at a simple process map which tells them very easily that if this has not happened, that means that it is a sterilization breakdown, and that means that they cannot give this load, cannot release this load for surgery, and they have to report. It's so simple. Their life can be simple if a simple process map is gently stuck on your OT semi-sterile area. Uniform care. There should be documented processes for everybody to fall back on. When your OT assistant, who has been there with you for 10 years, suddenly decides one day to leave your organization, what will you do now? Because you yourself don't know half the things what he was doing in the OT. But imagine a scenario when all those procedures are written down step by step, and it is so easy for you to recruit another person and just give him that SOP manual and say, follow this. Learn from mistakes. Whenever there is a mistake, that means an incident which can happen. It can be an adverse drug reaction, a medication error, a fall, a grievance, even a sentinel event like a fire or a surgical site infection. If you have done a root cause analysis, if you have done a CAPA, a corrective action and a preventive action, then you learn from your mistakes. Remember, the Japanese feel that a mistake is a treasure, because you learn so much from your mistakes. Recognize fatigue. Remember that your core staff, which is doing the most important work in your organization, and the most important work what we normally do in an eye hospital is operate. Remember that fatigue is something which should not dull the quality of their work, because their quality of work directly affects the patient outcomes. Teamwork, already spoken. Reduce confusion. Documentation of communication and communication of documentation. Whatever you are talking, that needs to be documented at some point, and people should know in the organization that these are the different documentation available. Continuous education, training, and then some more training. Let's touch the first area, operation theater, because that's the most important area. The basic documentation you need in an operation theater is the surgery list, surgery-related medical records, registers, checklist for disinfection, for day before surgery, on the day of the surgery, after surgery, and for terminal cleaning. These are extremely important documents which you should have as your SOPs and forms and formats. An SOP need not be a boring thing with just written down things. You know, we live in a digital world now. You can have videos as part of your SOP. You can have videos of communication happening at critical points. What are the critical points which happens, where communication happens between your staff and your patient, pre-operatively, post-operatively? Take videos of that with the permission of your patients, and that is your training tool for your next staff. And take pictures like that. Show them that this is the right way of doing things. This is the wrong way of doing things. It is. It make things idiot proof in your organization. That is the way you can ensure that your staff is well trained. Of course, we all know who this guy is. Can somebody tell me who this is? He is Dr. Atul Gawande. He is a gentleman who is right now in Boston. He was the one who released the surgical safety checklist and WHO approved it. So we have to be extremely proud of this gentleman that he introduced the concept of surgical safety checklist in surgeries. We need to incorporate this simple document in our OT records. And not just introducing the documents, there are three things which needs to be rolled out like a drama with every patient wheeled in your operation theater. First is sign in, time out, sign out. Every time you do these things, things are confirmed and reconfirmed so that you do not have a wrong patient, a wrong eye, a wrong IOL, or a wrong procedure ever. And you are ready for this surgery. Yeah. Documentation. Why is it important? I've already spoken about that. Now I will tell you point-wise why is it very, very important. There is a 40-minute webinar on how to write SOP. I have taken that. It's freely available in the public domain. Please see that if you have time and if you're enthused enough to set some SOPs in your center, this is the first step you can do. Encourage your staff to see this webinar, how to write SOP. Because most of the NABH hospitals also, I go as an assessor, they have cut, copy, paste documents, and that is the most frustrating thing an assessor can see. And as if we do not know that it's cut, copy, paste. Because I see fracture SOPs in eye hospitals. And I'm not surprised. So documentation of monitoring. Whenever we have to understand that when you are a surgeon, and if you're a cataract surgeon like I am, you would know your phacoemulsification machine, your microscope very well. But there's a third machine which you should know, like the back of your hand. That is your autoclave machine, right? And you need to train your staff to meticulously document your sterilization cycles. This slide is an example of what all details can be monitored and documented. This makes your staff more knowledgeable, aware, more accountable. And in the worst case scenario where you have a surgical site infection, you can save your skin by showing that you had definitely autoclaved that particular set which was used for the case. So documentation without SOP, with SOP. Without SOP, patient record will be incomplete. Incomplete record leads to missing vital information, inaccurate data, continuity of treatment is compromised, and it results in the harming the reputation of the doctor or the hospital. With SOP, all the records are present. Medical records serve as proof of proper care if any disputes arise, and recall is possible in cases of surgical site infection. An OT scheduler. You know, an OT scheduler is the most important document in your organization. You need to keep it in your OT. Even if you have one surgery on that particular day, it's important to create an OT list and it should be filed in your records. And the OT list has a person responsible to make it. This should be printed one day before the OT and submitted to the OT in charge. And the name of the doctor or nurse who has compiled the OT list should be duly signed and to be put up in the OT. Accountability, the second point. Every person in the organization is responsible. You involve the people from the doorman to the chairman, the theater managers, the infection control team, the surgeons, the anesthetist. And make your center risk ready. What are the common risks what we have in an eye hospital? It could be an endophthalmitis or any other surgical site infection. If you have process maps and escalation maps ready in case of a sterilization failure or positive cultures, this kind of incidents, the chances that this happens are less. And if it happens, I will show you that just like a code blue form, you need to have a surgical site infection matrix form ready so that in that moment of panic, you do not forget some important things what you're supposed to do in a case of a genuine case of endophthalmitis. Medical emergencies and fire. Be ready for that. See that your team is trained for basic life support. And intervene before damage occurs. So this is a protocol on suspected case of surgical site infection. What all things should you will do? You cannot think that I have never had an endophthalmitis for the last, say, 5, 6 years or 10 years, and I'll see if something happens. No, you need to tell me now that if you had an endophthalmitis today, what will you do? So that is where a record, a pre-printed format or a documentation will help you. Patient details. This is the code blue form which I was talking about. This is available freely in public domain. But yeah, and grievance. Whenever there is a patient grievance, there has to be a CAPA. Without an SOP of how will you handle grievance. You remember a patient who has shown grievance, that patient needs to be tackled very, very systematically in a structured way, and you should have an SOP. How will you take care of this grievance? Inventory management. Everything should have a reorder level. Exclusively for your emergency drugs, things where you cannot have a stock out, you need to have a reorder level. It's a simple thing. I will show you a photograph of a reorder level. This is stuck on my OT refrigerator. For everything what is there in the refrigerator, there is the stock and then there's a reorder level. As soon as the number touches the reorder level, it's a no-brainer. The OT staff will order for this. So what is the formula for a reorder level? It's nothing very difficult. It is the number of that particular drugs used per day and the number of days your vendor will take to supply you that particular medicine. So that's A multiplied by B is equal to reorder level. So you decide a reorder level which will be separate for each of your medicine and see that your staff knows that once it reaches the reorder level, automatically they have to order it so that you never are in a sad, sorry position when you have a medical emergency and your emergency drug box does not have that particular medicine. LASA drugs, look-alike and sound-alike drugs should be kept separately. This is a dextrose and a mannitol together. In a panic situation, you might pick up either of the two. Appointments, Dr. Kuresh Maskati has very nicely said, talked to us about appointments without SOP and with SOP, what can happen for appointments. Registration. Registration itself is a process and you need to have a proper SOP for registration. I will share with you the SOP, what we have made for registration. This is also freely available in public domain. If you go to NABH website, there is a Lakshmi Memorial Hospital SOP available over there and you can check from there also. So every single thing is written down clearly and there is no discrepancy. Process maps. This is a registration process map. If you look at this process map, you will see that there are some prioritizing levels. If these prioritizing levels are documented and displayed clearly, your staff knows that if there is a patient of sudden loss of vision or an elderly patient waiting in your reception who is suddenly becoming uncomfortable, could be going into hypoglycemia, could be going into a cardiac arrest, that your staff should be able to recognize and immediately report. How will that happen? Only if your staff is trained and you have not relied on memory. These process maps, which are the critical process maps, are printed and displayed at appropriate areas in your organization. Investigation, whatever investigation you do, that needs to have the number of redos what you do with every test. That's again waste of time. You know, you do one test, the staff is not trained properly how to do it, you're going to repeat. Typically, a field analysis is something which is repeated so many times because your staff has not instructed your patient how to behave while the field analysis is going on. So these protocols are extremely important and these small things will make a sea difference in how the patient looks. Uniform care means every time when the patient comes to your organization, they know that this is what I will get. You know, this differentiates between having a chai at a dhaba and having the same tea in a five-star hotel. There is a difference. I'm not talking about five-star culture in an organization, but the uniformity in care is equivalent to a five-star culture for a healthcare organization. Consulted communication, enough and more has been stressed by Dr. Maskati, how much time you need to spend and how. And I agree with him that you cannot be distracted with mobile phones while you are talking. So the treatment of plan, in fact, if you are having more than one consultant in your organization, it is very important to decide what are the points which will be captured during consultation. Because next time for follow-up, this patient might come and see another doctor. And please, if you are asking for an investigation, you should also write why have you asked for the investigation, so that your thought process is shared by the next doctor who might see this patient. Typically, the patient will complain, I went there, I saw one doctor and the next doctor and there was a confusion. They did not even agree on what treatment should have been given. That cannot happen in your organization at all. Your team of doctors should agree on the clinical practice guidelines. In fact, the 10 common diagnoses, that is also an NABH mandation, that the 10 common diseases what you encounter in your OPD, there should be common clinical pathways set out for your team of doctors, so that if a patient comes to you, there is continuity of care, even if the patient does not get to meet you in the follow-up appointment. Counseling, extremely important. And without an SOP, even the counselor has to have an SOP. This is how the counselor is going to talk. Point one, point two, point three, point four, written down. So that there is no discrepancy. It's not that the counselor is in a good mood today. He's going to talk for 10 minutes and the counselor is, oh my God, so tired. He's going to cut off within 2 minutes and half the points are no. So there can be a small checklist which is created for your counselor, so that your cataract patient who has heard your name and come to you will not get disappointed because the counselor was not in a good mood. Insurance, of course, Dr. Maskati does not need to bother with this, but lesser mortals like us still have to. And so there should be a with SOP and without SOP in insurance also. If you have a proper insurance, and Dr. Maskati, can I lure you into this? SOPs will help to give clarity to the patients on conditions which are in the control of the hospitals and the areas which are not under control of hospital.
True.
So whatever happens at the end of the day, the patient is not cursing you at all. And that is what we were able to do in the Silicon City of India, Bangalore. We love to see responses like this on Google when the patients, and I don't feel bad at all, more than praising the doctors are praising the processes and the systems in the hospital. And we are extremely proud of that. We rejoice that every time such a Google review comes up. So friends, isn't it about time that we celebrate what we are doing and put in a little more effort and time into having standardized operations in our hospital? It's definitely worth doing it. This is my team. I'm nothing without my team. And we run a knowledge sharing platform in my hospital in Bangalore, where every 3 to 4 months, we run a 2 days exhaustive course on implementation of quality and safety standards, which will also get you ready for implementing NABH standards in your hospital. But irrespective of that, it helps you improve quality and safety in your hospitals. Thank you so much for a patient listening. I now request Dr. Krishna Prasad Kudlu to take over. I have been to his organization in Udupi, and I can tell you for sure that he's almost like a demigod in that area of our country. Over to you, Dr. KP. Tell us, how do you maintain that status?
Thank you, Dr. Samir. Nothing is remaining to talk because Samir and you and Dr. Maskati finished everything. But what a great moment to be part of this instruction course. There is a reason I keep asking Samina that please include me part of your instruction course, so that every time I learn along with Mohita so many things out of you. Great knowledge, and I think this course has to be, I think we'll try our level best to put in Hall A in coming days in the morning session. There's going to be more and more.
Thank you. That's so kind of you, Dr. KP. Yeah. Thanks a lot.
Okay, thank you so much. I think most of the things I think she might have covered, but I practice in Tier 3 city, but after listening to her and sir, I think it's not the question of whether it is Tier 3 city or Tier 2 city or Tier 1 city. The protocol should be the same only. So I think I'll be talking about the patient loyalty. Who is loyal? So I'm just picking up the exact definition of loyalty. Giving or showing firm and constant support or allegiance to a person or institution. He remained loyal to the government. This is the definition. I got it from one of the website. So who are the patient? You call them loyal. So whether the patient come back to you, repeated consultation, you call them their loyal patient, we need to see. why they become loyal to you, whether it is trust in your clinical judgment or confidence in your surgical skill. It's all depend upon, as the previous speaker said, that you have to spend time with the patient. The few things already sir already told, one is mobile call. I also keep telling our consultants, I have around 18 consultants are working with me, no phone call in front of the patient, and also you cannot look at the laptop or mobile. Suddenly message comes, when the patient comes, they will be sitting in front of you and you will be keep chatting with someone, then okay, tell me. No, you have to be, once they come, you have to welcome yourself, then you talk them. This is one of the reason patient will become more and more loyal. Of course, once it all becomes with your direct approach to the patient, then they start referring their relatives and friend to you. They may come to you once, you might have given the treatment, but if you not followed whatever the previous speaker said, that then they are not going to come back to you. So how we have to build a patient-doctor relationship, this is very, very important. It's not only up to give the clinical prescription. Because of my All India election, I started roaming around last 1 year. My practice has dropped for almost 20 to 30%. I'm just going through, why exactly? Because my other consultant, they just see the patient, they write the prescription, send. But there is no personal contact. See, what I have started, because I started from a small clinic, I started from government hospital practice to I'm having a 5 centers. Basically, my asset, whenever patient comes, my memory is very good. Whenever he comes to me, normally I call his name. Something like, his name is Lokesh. Lokesh, please come sit. You are from, belongs to this area. If you tell them no, they'll be like on the skies. What doctor remembers me still? Even after 1 or 2 years, if you, what most of us, we have to do, before the patient comes, if you look at your directory there, okay, which patient is going to come, if you call them in their name, that gives you a lot of plus point with the patients. You, and most of the patient, when they come to ophthalmologist, the treatment I give or Dr. Mohita or Dr. Samina gives the same only. Same rubric rating, some of the brand might be different. But you have to be there in a position to listen to their, sometimes their problems also. Patient come to us and their eye problems will be much lesser. Sir, raat mein thoda burning hai or some watering. But they want to share their personal feeling with the doctors. In such time, no, don't tell here and all. That afterwards, whenever you call me, no. We have to spend time with the patient. We have to keep listening to them. Some of the time, I even give them a lot of suggestion. So, no, you are having some problem with your children. You give your son's phone number. I'll talk with your son so that he'll come and see you repeated visit. Then most of them, as sir said, that most of the patients are old patients. So they'll be like thinking, oh, my son is working in Mumbai, my son is working in Bangalore, I'm staying alone in the house. And when they come, rather their complaint will be very less, but they want to express their feeling with the doctor. So you have to spend time with them, give them some confidence, hold their hand, make them to sit in front of you. Then that gives you a lot of confidence, that makes you to have a more and more relationship. So coming to the support staff, I think the first speaker, Samir Sood, has already told the patient should have a good relation always with the support staff. To have a good relationship with the support staff, always your staff also has to be very happy. So keeping your staff happy is also very, very important. Otherwise, see, you will be every time keep scolding to the staff. My wife actually doing administrator of my this thing, I keep telling her, don't scold, okay? If you scold, keep scolding this staff, no? Tomorrow's OPD, at least 5-6 OPD number will be down. Don't scold them. So if you keep talking to them in very nicely, then I think when the patient comes to you, otherwise, when the patient comes, okay, what is your name? They just want to refer, no. If they smile, they receive it, this thing, they hold their hand, make them to sit in the reception, this thing, that makes a lot of sense. Of course, when they're waiting in the waiting room also, you have to go and talk with them, what is the problem, then which doctor they want to see, that gives a lot of confidence to the patient. Of course, most of us, I think nowadays, having optometrists. I think you might have seen those are having optometrists. Some of the optometrists are so good, they become so close when they come inside. Sir, whatever you are telling, already doctor inside told. Anything extra you want to say, you tell. Because they might have already told you, sir, aapka cataract hai. Then they are talking with them. I have seen one of my optometry talking their whole house story, that thing, this thing. Very close to the patient. When they come, andar sir, doctor ne sab kuch bola hai, cataract parda hai. Anything else you want to talk. So the optometrist performance inside the hospital also very, very important. Then, of course, as sir said that, about the counselors, what she said is one valid point. I think I'm going to start that SOP for counselor also. Every time they have to talk, if their mood is not good, then they may finish up the counseling by 1.5 minutes or half a minute over. Sir, I counseled that patient is never going to come back for cataract surgery. So reassurance by the counselor is also very, very important. But in Karnataka, we most of us depend upon the insurance, sir. I think you all done a great job banning insurance in Mumbai. I think probably one or the other day we also have to look into that part. But for us, of course, insurance is our bread and butter. Most of the time what I have seen, after you talk so well, your counselor talks so well, then they go to the insurance. These people treat them in a different way. Because someone is paying 35,000, they pay, the treatment is different. Once they come with this cashless card, because this insurance staff will have in their mind, 30,000 it will come after some income tax cut and that cut, this cut, the hospital is going to get 20,000. They themselves act one type with the patient. Sir, sit sir, card, tell your son to send email or send WhatsApp, then tell them to make wait for hours together in insurance. What and all the great job you have done along with your counselor and plus your optometry. If she spoils, everything gone. That experience is also very, very important. Even after you do surgery, after you see the patient OPD, if your billing staff probably make them to wait for half an hour or 45 minutes, then it makes a nonsense out of that. So each staff probably, I think one take-home message I got from Samina, that we need to have SOP for each department. Am I right?
Yeah, for sure.
So keeping your staff happy, I think Samir already showed that taking them out for, party. Then it should not be like every month party and all. Then they may always waiting for that kind of party and they may not perform. So yearly once, one particular month, take them and you expect from them. And always repeated meeting with the staff is very important because our ophthalmology is a instrument-driven or industry-driven department. So you need to have a repeated meeting, monthly at least one meeting with each department that make your patient, like overall practice into a different level. And repeat updating for them. And I don't think that even some of the hospital nowadays, I don't know in north, but in south, they started giving them the incentives. If they do a good job, per month one meeting, they will tell the staff of the month, that kind of some award if you give them, definitely it is going to have your practice is going to give the different level. Okay, give them some responsibility. Responsibility means you are having some package. I'll just take a half a minute or one
no
minute.
Problem.
You are having some package, for example. They should have some power with them that gives some sort of discount. For example, counselor should, suppose if bill is around 25,000, but at least she should have something margin to give at least 1,000 discount. So that patient will feel very happy that she herself from her own try to give some discount. So allow them some responsibility. Of course, push them to achieve target, not as a achieve the cataract target. Whatever the goals, whatever the job you are giving them, whether they are doing or not, we have to be keep monitoring by doing the repeated meeting. So I think sir might have already told about the waiting time. I think these days, I think time is scarce commodity for many. See, what I see, suppose one patient comes, I tell my retina department, because vision, refraction, dilatation, fundus, and they do OCT and fundus photo. Maximum, it should finish by 1 to 1.5 hours. I keep fighting, I fight most of the time with my retina guys only. So they come late also. And then over that, they make the patient late. Because most of them are diabetic. They come at morning 10 o'clock. What it makes sense by sending them 4 o'clock or 3 o'clock? your diagnosis might be ultimate, your treatment might be very good, you might have given a very good Avastin injection, but you make them to wait for 4 or 5 hours. I keep telling them 1-1.5 hours I think for OPD is maximum, or someone coming for cataract surgery, I feel that within 3 hours the overall process should finish. Registration, physician checkup, surgery and out. I think that gives you, get the more and more loyal patient. If at all, if it really require admission, then only you admit, otherwise don't admit them. So coming to the counselor, of course, they are the very important people. Now I think last couple of months, because of I think practice dropped or nothing, I just changed my counseling pattern. What we used to do before whenever patient is having cataract, we used to tell, sir, you are having cataract, then she is going to tell the remaining thing. But these people, of course, we don't have SOPs. Each patient, they may talk differently. Finally, they end up in whatever the package they said. Now, I tell them what is their, I go up to their, what is their expectation. I will not talk about the money. What is their expectation, whether patient wants a monofocal or multifocal by looking at the keratometry reading and other primary things. Till that level, I talk to them, then I send it to the counselor. So, then when the patient referred to the counselor, call them before one patient come inside. See, these are the things I spoke to the patient. They want to get rid of their glasses, but don't talk to them now. But patient very much interest of get rid of their glasses, get one's OCT done. Because after counseling for multifocal, if you have got a macular hole, there is a, once again, get them back to monofocal, it is a nonsense. Get one OCT done, if possible, topo done. Everything's fine, then do a IOL master, then you talk with the patient. So the counselor is very, very important. And I always feel that counselors should always travel. Whenever the patient comes for cataract surgery, counselors should travel with the, accompanying the patient from OPD to the OT, and when they come back also just with them. So they'll be very happy when they come to me for post op, what sir, what staff you are having? She has taken care about me. Why I called my son from Bangalore? I would have come alone and have got my surgery done. No, son is working in Bangalore, not from, patient is from my place only. Samina is already very tense. She is thinking some other SOP has to be done for that also.
Sir is taking away patients from Bangalore then.
Try and be always, always you have to talk with the patient and try to solve their problem. And when I tell my counselor, if I call also, don't receive. Anybody call, don't receive the phone. You are talk one-to-one point contact. Directly look at the patient, keep talking to them.
Then Dr. KP, we'll have to wrap up now.
Last slide.
We have two more talks.
Unhappy. Coming to the unhappy patient, I think it has to be addressed by the doctor only. Why patient is unhappy? Whether my treatment is ineffective, then any other alternative modalities has to be done, or where I have missed my diagnosis. This has to be tackled by the patient only. This is my last side. Whenever there is a surgical complication, I personally feel that doctor himself has to tackle that problem. Be sure that, be always there with the patient all the time, till whether they get the vision back or not is secondary. Whenever, be with the patient, hold their hand till the end, then they are not going to make you any grumbling. So everyone in the hospital should speak one language whenever there is complication. In the end, I think billing, of course, every patient like discount. So if you give small discount also, they go and tell that they are given a good discount. So along with that, if there are time in the billing department, insurance department, that makes a lot of sensible. And be flexible on payment. In conclusion, achieving patient loyalty is a team effort. Every department in the hospital has role in it. Keeping the loyalty after achieving it is far more difficult. Consistency in delivering excellent outcomes is key. Once again, I thank Samina for a wonderful opportunity. Thank you, Samina.
Dr. KP, thank you. We all know now why he's so popular, because of his frank nature. And I now welcome Dr. Mohita Sharma, who runs a fantastic organization called Tirupati Eye Hospital in Delhi. She's also the secretary for the Women of Ophthalmologist Society All India. And her center is NABH accredited. She's going to talk to us about communication, which is extremely important. I would want each one of you to think about reading a book known as The Blink. Blink talks about intuition, and you should remember that the patient decides about you. A new patient decides about you, actually thin slices you in the first 3 minutes of their encounter. So in the first 3 minutes in which the patient enters your room, and if you're too distracted or if you're not making eye contact, you've lost out those three very important, the golden minutes of your interaction. Keep that in mind and keep thinking that how you can practice mindfulness and being right there. When the patient is there, you forget everything and just be with the patient. Over to Dr. Mohita to tell us about communication, what to communicate, and mostly what not to communicate, or what are the wrong ways of communication. Thank you, Dr. Mohita. Come.
So good afternoon, everybody. So before I start, I just wanted to make one comment on the counseling part that you had talked about. Two things which we learned with time, so I thought I can share with you. One was in the counseling part, what we are doing now is, initially it was that we explained some bit, then we sent to the counselor, and then the patient was gone. Now we always call back the patient to the doctor, and we find that whatever package the counselor has taken to, the doctor can upgrade the package at least by one package after talking to the this thing to a more premium lens if the doctor feels that it is suitable. So we always call the patient back, and we don't allow the patient to go off like this.
But we don't, whatever she tells the package, that's going to be final. We are not normal in my practice. I don't increase the package, but I tell them to get back to me whether they counseled in the proper way. But yeah, it's up to each person.
Yeah. And the second thing, this was one, and second point I've also forgotten. Something else I had remembered. Okay, so now let's talk about better communication. Again, already everything almost has been covered, so I'll just quickly go through whatever I had to say. Now, I start by saying that we all take the Hippocratic Oath, and when we take the Hippocratic Oath, we want to do everything in a very ethical manner, and we start practicing with our best of expertise. Yet we find that our patients are unhappy few times. Our patients go in for litigation also, and sometimes the doctors are beaten up also. So the commonest cause for this is whenever you talk about doctors being beaten up, or whenever you talk about patients going in for litigations, commonest cause you will find is there has been a communication gap. And hence communication skills become effective for all of us. And they not only improve the patient satisfaction, but they also help us grow in practice, and they decrease the medical lawsuits. So our knowledge is important, but it is also important that we elicit all information out of the patient so that we make a better diagnosis. And this we do by various ways which have been already talked about by the previous speakers. So a few things that I would like to add here is, first of all, the most important thing is that we have to, in communication, we have to respect our patients. Very, very important. The patient who's sitting there in your waiting room may be your mother, your father, your brother, or your sister. So I found that in my setup, in all our setups, in fact, when the patient is called, the patient is generally called by name. My people used to come and go to the waiting room, and suppose the patient's name is Ramesh. They will go and say Ramesh within the... They will go and call Ramesh Andar Aiye. Without even checking as to what the age of the patient is, this Ramesh may be, Ramesh is my father's name, his name is R.C. Sharma. So one day I wondered if this patient was my father, the person did not even check that this patient was 70-year-old and went and called him Ramesh. So if this was my father, I would have been so offended. So that day I told all the people who were working in my setup that whenever you go and call the patient to meet the doctor, you go and first check the age, and everybody has to be addressed with respect, and it has to be Mr. So-and-so or Miss So-and-so, etc., etc. And since then, everything changed. Then the next step that I did was, in fact, I had gone for a fellowship to Germany, and I found there is no such system that somebody else goes and calls the patient. We are sitting like bosses in our chambers. The doctor always goes out, calls the patient, and welcomes the patient inside. And since then, our system is like this. We don't have anybody who goes and calls the patient inside. All the doctors in our setup go to the waiting room. They call the patient, Mr. So-and-so, please come inside. inside. We, in fact, we open the door and we say, please come in and sit. And the dog, that same, as soon as we do that, there is such an instant connect with the patient. 90% of the times we do this. 10% if it is too heavy and we are not able to manage this, somebody else calls the patient. It makes a huge difference in the connect that happens with the patient. Next thing is we introduce ourselves and we explain who we are, and then we also many a times we shake hands with the patient, and sometimes and each time we also give an acknowledgement to the relative also who has come inside and tell them to sit. Now these simple things that you do, you will find that there is an instant connect with the patient, apart from the many other things which have been talked about by the previous speakers. So this is all which we do in the first go. As has already been said, eye contact is very, very important. And as Sir just said, that all of us have our hospital management systems now. So we are sitting and typing. That should never, never be done. In fact, with every doctor, we have connected one optometrist so that the optometrist does the typing work, and the doctor is just giving the instructions. This is an extra investment you may have to do, but if you have to do this, it is important, because you cannot be spending your time typing on the computer. You have to be talking to the patient. Otherwise, you'll find that you're here, you are typing, and your back is to the patient and to the relatives, and the patient is totally, totally dissatisfied. Rather, somebody else has to be doing this work. This part is very, very important. Your appearance also is important. You cannot be sloppily dressed up as on the left side. You have to be nicely dressed up in a formal manner, and you should be neat and clean, and you should be conservatively dressed up, which your profession demands. Now, many a times from my field of vision, I can see that when I'm examining the patient, the patient's relatives are looking at me from up to down, not just as me, they look at every doctor, because doctors are like role models still in the society. So they will see what footwear you are wearing, what dress you are wearing. And many of my, in fact, most of my female patients will come up and say, my children want to be like you, my children want to dress up like you, my daughter is very impressed by you. This is because they look up upon you as a role model, and you have to be well-dressed whenever you go for work. You have to be fluent in your dialogue. You have to use silence very effectively and allow the patient to express. Very important, we all know this. You have to use supportive words. You have to ask open explanatory questions, and you have to use a very adjusted language. You cannot use any foul language, however angry you may be. Empathy is, of course, the most important thing. Do not sympathize with the patient, but empathize with the patient, which means that put yourself in the patient's shoes. Now, in our curriculum, we are not taught how to deal with a patient who's angry, how to deal with a patient who's violent, etc., but this should be a part of the curriculum. So if a patient is, there was one communication skills course which I attended very early in my career, where they made us do some role plays, and they did a role play where they said that one patient is angry, how will you deal with the patient? You are sitting in your clinic, and in the waiting area, there is an angry patient. So the first thing they said was, and which I always follow, us, we all have angry patients. In our clinics, it's not possible that none of us had an angry patient in the waiting room. And the commonest cause for anger is waiting period. So at that time, we were taught that just go outside and say, just call the patient inside. Whoever is, if there's a shouting patient, call the patient inside, make him sit. And the first sentence that you should say is, I understand whatever is your problem. After asking what the problem was, the first thing should be, I understand what your problem is. And if I was in you, probably this is the same thing that I would also be doing. But I'm sorry for what happened. So when you say this line, if I was you, I would have probably also did the same thing. They immediately change. This one line changes them totally. Though probably if I was them, I would not have done that. but you have to say that you would have done that. And this actually has worked 100% for me always. So that's what empathy is. So in empathy, the power of touch is also very important. Now, I have a lot of patients which I found that Now, if they come and you've advised them surgery, suddenly they are tensed and there is a man who's got his mother and suddenly she's very tensed while they are going, just touch them like this a little and say, everything will be okay, we will do the best for you. That touch brings that immediate and instant connect, and that's the power of touch. And after that, that man will go back and say, I don't know, doctor, what you do to this patient, she will not go anywhere and she just wants you to operate and nobody else. It's just that simple touch in which while going, you told her that everything will be okay and I'll treat you as if it was my mother or my father. So that itself makes that difference, which it should. So the commonest complaint we all know is that the doctor is not listening, and that's the commonest reason for for our patients being dissatisfied. So listening and that effective silence is very, very important. And I said all these should be in our curriculum, and if it's not in our curriculum, then you should be attending these sessions to understand how best to deal with them. Though we are speaking it out, I know many of you are good practitioners here and you all have been facing it. It is just that we are speaking it and you are connecting with it. And so everything is getting reinforced for you also and for us also. So effective communication definitely reduces litigations. That is one very big benefit. And the benefit to the doctor is that ours is a very, very emotionally demanding profession. If there's an effective communication, there is a very positive environment. And this is what we want. If every day we work under positivity, then we are going to feel good. So all our paramedical and medical staff should also be communicating in a very effective manner, and they should be communicating the same as what you are communicating. So everything should be in the sync. Whatever we say should match with what they say, and what they say should match with what we say. If there's a differing information, then the patients tend to get confused. Hence the importance of meetings that was being talked about. There have to be regular meetings where we explain to them whatever needs to be told to them. Communication with the team, amongst the team, is also very important, because this is the commonest cause of medication errors, for wrong side surgery, for delayed treatment, and it is responsible for high attrition also. So it is important we do meetings with them and they communicate with each other in an effective manner. Now, hence, we should be choosing HMS system which will make these communications more effective. We should be having regular trainings, just as Dr. Kudlu said that if you train them regularly about the equipment and improve their skills, it's going to improve the communication also. One very effective way of communication, which I feel, is mobile phones. Now, we used to be discouraging our staff using mobile phones, but now we feel that mobile phone is the quickest and the fastest, it is the quickest way of communication. So now we tell them to be on their mobiles, but because that's the best, WhatsApp is the quickest form of communication. Now, especially if you have a bigger setup or even a smaller setup where there are different areas, for example, the OT, OPD, etc. The WhatsApp is the way by which we are communicating nowadays, though this is something which we used to discourage before, because emails is not the way. A phone call also somebody may pick up or not pick up, but WhatsApp they'll always see. And your staff has to be given a voice, and they should be asked as to where that effective communication is lacking so that you can take steps to improve that. So I think
there's a 5-minute talk which Dr. Gagan has missed, how to make your hospital safe. Can I just do that and then we can do the video? Is that all right?
Okay. Yeah? I think if the next session is there, we can skip the video also.
No, there's no next session actually. Now,
there's no next session.
So we can actually do the video. But let me just finish this 5 minutes talk, Dr. Gagan Dudeja, on how to make your hospital safe. Yeah.
Gagan. Any questions for Dr. Mohita about communication? One thing which I have found very useful is that, see, when the things are going good, there's really no problem. But especially when you have a problem, say if you have a complication or if your patient's vision is not improved according to his or her expectations, this patient is going to go to the optometrist room first, isn't it? And a vision will be checked. Post-operative patient, day one patient enters your optometrist room, the vision is counting fingers. It can be a possibility, right? Now, what is the, when you say communication, is it only about spoken words? It's about the body language and the tone and the tenor of your voice. So they are looking at the optometrist's face. And you know, that kind of expression they have, the body language, because normally 90% of your, 95% of your patients, they might be seeing 6, 6, 6, 6. The optometrist is also used to seeing 6, 6. And he will keep on saying, nahi dikh raha, you're not able to see, you're not able to see. 3 times he's asking, you're not able to see. You need to train that optometrist. You need to talk to the optometrist. Because by the time the patient comes to your room, the patient already feels that there is a big complication. And the next few days when there are some 50 relatives are going to come and meet this patient, till the time your cornea clears up, he's going to say, pata nahi, I don't know what has happened in my eye. Okay? That eye will recover, but those 50 relatives who have met him and gone will have this lingering feeling that this surgery was done there and there was some problem. So where is the problem? You would handle it very well, I'm sure. But when the optometrist has not handled it correctly, not even the spoken words, he or she has not told anything also, but the body language, the facial expressions of this smiling optometrist before the surgery and this stunned optometrist after the surgery is going to convey a lot of information to your patients. Another thing, if there is an infection, if there is something like that, and you need to have the common communication. What, like Dr. Mohita said, it's very, very important that the communication should be the same. There should not be any discrepancy in the communication, because they, if they find a gap about of, in what you are telling and what your staff is telling, that is going to create a lot of confusion. So I will quickly run through this presentation of Dr. Gagan Dudeja. He is a senior NABH assessor and an oculoplasty surgeon at Narayan Netralaya. He couldn't be here. He's presenting a paper at the Rangachari session. So he's requested me to talk on his behalf. This is a fire we know at the Noida Metro Hospital at the Bhubaneswar. So what is the problem? Why did the fire happen? And it can happen. It is not that it will never happen in your hospital. Okay? You need to have fire safety. Okay, not as a part of any mandation or any benchmarking. Please go and get a fire audit done of your hospital. Even if you are remotely not thinking about NABH, see that a third party fire audit is done and the basic firefighting equipments are there. Your staff is trained on mock drills on fire. This is very important. It can happen in your hospital also. Okay, electrical safety, looking at all these things. What do you think about this? Yes, you can prevent this. Facility inspection rounds have to be incorporated. Hazard identification, risk reduction, regular inspection and maintenance, staff training, mock drills, and inspection. So there has to be one person in your organization. A lot of people during this instruction course told you that job description is very important. Every person working in your organization should have written down job description. And one of your staff can have this job description of a facility safety officer also. Okay, besides doing what they are doing. But when they are a facility safety officer, they also have this added responsibility of going around for facility rounds in your organization. So there has to be a system of reporting of incidents. I also spoke about that, of falls, adverse drug events, and sentinel events. What are sentinel events? These are the never events. They should never happen in your organization. Right? A wrong eye surgery, wrong procedure. And that's where we spoke about a surgical safety checklist, that how that can prevent such an incident in your hospital. 24/7 availability of all these things in your hospital, medical gases, look into your emergency drug. Think that if you had a relative or you yourself had a kind of a cardiac arrest in your own hospital, will you be saved? Think about it. Is there somebody else who is trained on basic life support, on CPR? Do you have enough emergency drugs? Does your oxygen cylinder have oxygen? Does your nurse or staff or anybody knows how to open that oxygen cylinder and how to put a mask on your face? Very important. Occupational health hazards in healthcare, biological hazards, chemical hazards, physical hazards, ergonomic. We use a lot of disinfectants in our hospital, right? All these are hazardous substances. And you need to have the safety data sheets or the material safety data sheets for that, okay? Your staff should be aware. This can get spilled. This can go into the eyes. This can corrode your skin. Somebody can accidentally drink that. It has happened all the time, right? So you need to see if that happens, how is your staff ready to prevent that? So this is what I've already told you. Display information regarding hazardous things or warning signs. Spill management. If there is a patient who has vomited blood in your organization, this can lead to communicable diseases. How do you manage spills? And hand hygiene. In an ophthalmology hospital, when I go as an assessor, hand hygiene takes a back seat because we feel we are the clean branch. That's not true. Hand hygiene is still important, very important. And there is a wonderful hand hygiene tool, audit tool, which WHO has given, that is there in public domain. You can do a once in a month, one of your staff can do a hand hygiene audit. That takes care of so many of your hospital acquired infection. In fact, that will reduce the number of absentees in your organization because all these common colds and all is because of lack of hand hygiene also. Safe injection and medication practices, extremely important. It can happen, things can go wrong. And we need to look into, especially if you are having a dispensary or a pharmacy, or even if not, if you're running an operation theater, you need to look at your medications. You need to look at where you're going to store them, what is the expiry dates, who is going to track them, what are the look-alike, sound-alike drugs, which are the high-risk drugs, and how will you take care of the high-risk drugs. Safe surgery, we already spoke about surgical safety checklist, and safety and accessing facility. Important, grab bars, we deal with elderly people. Look at your toilets, see whether they are they elderly friendly. Very, very important. And code blue, we spoke about code blue in the during this course before also, so I'll skip this part. But you need to have some codes in your hospital, especially the code pink, the code blue, and the code red. The code pink is when you have a child abduction or when a child is missing in your organization. Thank you so much. If there are any questions, I and Mohita can take them. But thank you for sticking by and sitting through. And I hope you've enjoyed this course. Hoping to see you all next year. Thank you so much.